Great is his faithfulness, church. Great is his faithfulness, church. Great is his faithfulness, church. Great is his faithfulness. Great is his faithfulness. Great is his faithfulness. Great. Greatest is faithfulness, church. I want to read something to you this morning. In Psalms 139, the psalmist David said something that stuck with me all week. And he said, in verse 7, he said, "Whither shall I go from thy spirit?" In other words, where can I go that your spirit is not already there? Where can I go? What can I do? No matter what I'm dealing with, where can I go that your spirit is not already there? He says, "Whether shall I flee from thy presence?" He said, no matter where I go, your presence is there. He said, if I ascend up into heaven, he said, you are there. He said, if I make my bed in hell, behold, you are there. He said, if I take the wings of morning and I dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there shall thy hand lead me and thy right hand shall hold me. No matter where I go, the presence of the Lord is there. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord. Father, no matter where I go, you're there. I bless you this day because of your faithfulness. I bless you because of your faithfulness. I bless you because when I need you, you're right there. I bless you because when I need comfort, you're faithful. I bless you because when I need peace, you're faithful. I bless you because when I need mercy and grace, you're faithful. Lord, I thank you because when I'm not even good to myself, you're still good to me. You're faithful. Father, I thank you this day. I thank you for your presence. And I bless you this day. In Jesus' name, amen. Guys can be seated. It's amazing what happens when you just sit in the presence of God. It's amazing how you lose sight of everything else that's going on outside. It's amazing how when you sit in his presence, you find peace, you find joy, you find strength that you didn't even know that you had. You find security, you find love. So much, worship team. You guys can be dismissed. Thank you. Thank you. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. You may not feel like it, but you have a reason to smile this morning. You may not feel like it, but you got a reason to smile this morning. You've got a reason to laugh this morning. I don't know about you, but I serve a God that created the heavens and the earth, and that can do anything. And while what you're facing may seem like it's insurmountable and you can't overcome it, I got news for you. You serve a big God. You serve a big God. Sometimes we forget that. Sometimes we forget that we serve a big God. Sometimes we let life, we let it consume us. We let it choke the word out of us. We let it suck the life out of us. But let me tell you something. You've got a reason to smile this morning. Let's try something. On the count of three, everybody just smile. I know that it sounds weird. You might even say, Pastor, I don't have anything to smile about. Oh, but you do, because you're living and you're breathing and you're sitting here. You can praise God. You can stand up. You can clap. You can... So on the count of three, I just want y'all to smile. One, two, three. I want to see everybody's teeth. I want to see everybody's teeth. Everybody's teeth. I got to see everybody's teeth. It don't even matter if you've been to the dentist recently. I still want to see your teeth. See, it's okay to laugh. It's okay to laugh. Sometimes we gotta laugh so we don't cry. The Bible says laughter is like medicine to my soul. And how many know sometimes we just need a little bit of medicine? Sometimes we need just a little bit of medicine. This morning, I want to share something with you. This scripture has been eating at me the last 2 weeks. God has had me in the scripture in the last 2 weeks. And I believe he's got a good word for you. The title to the message is, How Much Are You Willing to Pay? How much are you willing to pay? Don't turn me off yet. I'm not asking for money today. Not today. Can't promise about next week, but not today. But the question is, how much are you willing to pay? See, because you and I, when we want something, it doesn't matter how much it costs, we're willing to pay it. If we really want something, if it's something that we see that we really can't live without, we're willing to pay for it. See, my wife is willing to pay $200 or $300 for a purse because she really wants that purse. She was looking online the other day saying, oh, they got some new purses out. I was like, oh, Lord. I think it's Consuela bags or whatever. See, she's willing to pay that price for that purse. Even though she may not even have $200 in the purse, she's willing to pay $200 for the purse. See, there are times that we're willing to pay for whatever it is we want. If we really want something, we're willing to pay for it. If you really want a Mercedes, guess what? You're going to have to pay for it. Mercedes don't go on sale. There are some things in life that just don't go on sale. There are some things that you and I will experience that go on sale. If you want it, you're going to have to pay for it. Turn to your neighbor and say, I got to pay for it. I got to pay for it. See, how many of you know that God doesn't go on sale? Woo. See, how many of you know that the presence of God is not for sale? How many of you know that the things of God are not for free and they're not for sale, but it is going to cost you something? How many of you know that if you want to experience the presence of God, if we want the glory of the Lord to fill this place, you're going to have to be willing to pay for something? How many of you know if we want to see God do something new, it's going to cost you? How many of you know if we want revival and if we want restoration, this is the year of restoration. If we want it, guess what? It's going to cost you something. It's not free. Salvation is free. Salvation is free. But an intimate walk with Jesus Christ costs you something. Turn to your neighbor and say, I got to pay for it. Today, we're going to be in the book of 2 Chronicles. And in this scripture, where we are, where I'm going to start, prior to this scripture, what has happened is this. Solomon has finally completed the temple. He's built it. Solomon's goal was to build the temple. And he built the temple, and it took over 150,000 laborers to build this temple. Whoa, good Lord, 150,000 laborers. And it was beautiful. I mean, some of it had pure gold in it. Even the stones sparkled, baby. It was a beautiful place. But the only thing that was missing was the presence of God. See, you might look pretty on the outside. You might look good on the outside. You might have your Sunday's best on. You might have your best in your closet on. You might have taken a shower today. You might have brushed your teeth today. You might have put on makeup today. But the question is the Spirit of God missing in your life? Is the glory of the Lord missing in your life? Because you can look pretty all you want to, but if the glory of the Lord is missing, your fruits are going to show and everybody's going to be able to see that you're not as pretty as you look. See, I know when you leave the house, you look in the mirror, you fix your mustache, you fix all this, you look at your makeup and you say, "Oh, I look good." But as soon as you open your mouth, I can tell that the glory of the Lord is missing and you don't look as good as you thought you did. Are you willing to pay for the glory? Are you willing? How much are you willing to pay for the glory of the Lord to operate in your life? So Solomon built it. He built the temple. The only thing that was missing was the presence. So Solomon builds the temple and he prays. And he says, "God, I'm praying for a revival in your people, and I'm praying for restoration in your people." And guess what God does? God shows up and shows out. And he fills that place. Fire comes down, consumes the sacrifices, and God fills the temple with his glory. He fills the temple with his glory. And for 15 days straight, they have a party celebrating the glory of the Lord. Whew. They had a 15-day party. See, you thought you knew how to party. You thought you knew how to get down. You thought you knew how to celebrate. See, I know some of y'all, when your family gets together, baby, y'all know how to do it. And y'all would do it for a full day. But this said 15 days straight that they celebrated and they had a party because of the glory of the Lord filling this place. I wish we were willing to pay the price so that the glory would fill this place and we could party for 15 days straight. So after 15 days, Solomon makes it home. He ain't been home in 2 weeks because he's been partying. Solomon makes it home after 2 weeks. And then, see, Solomon thought he was done already. He got, the glory came down, and Solomon thought, "Woo, God answered, I'm done. We good." And then Solomon gets home after all the partying is over, after everything is quieted down, and he's got Solomon's attention. Now, God begins to share with Solomon. He begins to have this encounter with God. God begins to truly answer what his prayer was originally. And in 2 Chronicles chapter 7, and we're going to start in verse 12. And verse 12 says this: "And the Lord appeared to Solomon by night and said unto him, I have heard thy prayer and have chosen this place to myself for a house of sacrifice." In essence, God is saying this to Solomon: "I heard your prayer." He said, "You wanted me here, baby? Now I'm here." He said, "You were asking for me?" He said, "I'm here now." He said, "You've been looking for me? You've been praying for me? You want healing? You want restoration? You want revival? I'm here, baby." He said, "I'm here." He said, "But I need you to understand something He said, I need you to understand that what comes with it is sacrifice. Woo! He said, I need you to know that what comes with it is sacrifice and surrender. He said, there's a price, there's a cost to the glory. It doesn't come free. There's a cost. Woo. Lord, have mercy, help me. There's a cost to the glory. It's not free. It costs you something. He said, in other words, this is a house of sacrifice. You can't say anymore what you want to say. You can't do anymore what you want to do. You can't go anymore where you want to go. He said, this is now a new thing. You can't do the same thing you used to do. You can't have church like you used to have it. You can't come in here like you used to. If you want the glory, it's going to cost you something. That's why it's called a sacrifice. See, that's why the Bible calls it a sacrifice of praise. See, because it costs you something to praise. See, you come in this place and you've got all kinds of, Pastor, I don't feel like worshiping today. I don't feel like blessing the Lord today. I don't feel like praising Him today. Who said you had to feel like it? See, that's why it's called a sacrifice of praise. Because it's going to cost you a sacrifice to be able to praise. We're so busy bringing our junk in here. We're so busy with our flesh and what we want in here, instead of understanding that when we come in here, if we say, I know I don't feel like it, but Lord, you've been too good to me not to come into this place and praise you. You've been too good to me not to come in here and raise my hands and declare that you are faithful. You have been too good to me. You wanted me when nobody else wanted me. You loved me when nobody else loved me. You cared for me when nobody else wanted anything to do with me. You delivered me. You set me free. You gave your son for me. You broke the chains. You broke alcoholism in my life. You broke drug addiction in my life. So I might not feel like it because my boss was mad at me today, but you know what? I'm going to come into this place and I'm going to raise my hands and I'm going to bless you whether I feel like it or I don't. We say we want the glory. We say we want this place to be filled. We say we want to impact the county with the good news of Jesus Christ. What God is saying is, that's great, and I'm here. He said, but it ain't gonna be done the way you want it to be done. It ain't gonna be done the way you used to do it. Church can't happen the way it used to be. It's gotta be different. It's gotta be new. It's gotta be fresh. It's got to be us worshiping in spirit and in truth. It can't be you worried about what you did yesterday, what you did this morning, what your neighbor, how they're looking at you, whether they like you or not. I rightly don't care, because you didn't die for me. You didn't send your son for me. You didn't heal me. You weren't there when God found me. You weren't there when He brought me out. You weren't there when He set me free. You don't know the cost. Come on, Paulie, tell me. You don't know the cost of my praise. You don't know the cost of my praise. You don't know the hell I've gone through. You don't know what I've been through. You don't know what I've experienced. You don't know what I had to overcome. I'm not worried about whether you like me or not. What I want to know is if God is inhabiting my praises. God said, you wanted me? I'm here. You want me? I'm here, baby. But it can't be done the same way. We've been walking in flesh for too long. We've been walking in flesh for too long. We've been playing games. We've been walking in our flesh. If I don't feel like doing it, I ain't gonna do it, God. I'm glad he didn't do that when he gave me his son. I'm glad he didn't do me like that. You want to see God move? See, the sad part is we want to see God move when our life is falling apart. Then we want to show up. And then we want to be with God for 2 or 3 weeks. And he gets us out. And then we're nowhere to be seen again. And we don't see God again until something major happens in our life. But he said, if you want me, I'm here. But it's going to require sacrifice. And you can't just come to me when you want something. You got to come to me all the time. You got to seek me out all the time. It can't be when it's convenient for you. Lord, help me. Jesus Christ. But verse 13 says this. Lord, have mercy. So verse 12 was telling us it's going to be a sacrifice. It's going to be surrender. Verse 13 says, he starts off and he says, if, I need you to understand something. That's a very short word, but it's a very powerful word. God said, if. In other words, he's saying, he said, if. That word if means in the event that I choose. Woo! That's what God is saying to us. He said, if, in other words, in the event that I choose to shut up heaven and that there be no rain. Wait a minute. Then he said, or in the event that if I choose to command locusts to devour the land. Or if, in the event that I choose to send pestilence among my people. God is saying, in the event that he chooses to shut up heaven, because you got to know something. Solomon is freaking out right now. This is what God is telling Solomon. Solomon is freaking out right now because he's saying, God, this ain't what I'm praying for. He said, wait a minute. This is not, I promise you, God, this is not what I'm praying for. Solomon is saying, I'm praying that you open up heaven so that you can bless us. God is saying, but if I choose to shut up heaven and send no rain, will you still choose me? Woo! Solomon is saying, God, I'm praying to open up heaven. I'm praying that you bless the land, not devour the land. Solomon is saying, God, I'm praying for healing among the people. I'm not praying that you send pestilence. And God is telling Solomon, I hear what you're saying. He said, but I want to know something. But in the event that I choose to shut up heaven and send no rain, will you still choose me? He said, in the event that I choose to send locusts to devour your land, will you still choose me? In the event that I choose to send pestilence to the land, will you still choose me? You might be praying for healing, but it may not come. Will you still choose God? You may be praying for a promotion, but you lose your job instead. Will you still choose God? You may be praying that the windows of heaven are open, but God decides not to send any rain. The question is, will you still choose him? See, in other words, what God was telling Solomon is this. He said, I know you're praying for revival. I know you're praying for restoration. He said, but it might get worse before it gets better. Woo, that's only two people. A few minutes ago, y'all was rowdy. A few minutes ago, are you discovering how much you're willing to pay? Woo! Is that what's happening? You discovering that the cost might be greater than what you're willing to pay? I need you to understand something. God was telling Solomon, it might get worse before it gets better. But at the end, will you still choose me? See, because you guys were excited at the beginning of the year. Woo! 2022, I saw it all on Facebook. This is the year of restoration. It's the year of restoration. I saw that so many times, I couldn't even see them all. This is the year of restoration. This is the year of restoration. This is the year of restoration. And God said, yep, it is. And then things start happening. Things didn't go the way you thought they were going to go. Life wasn't happening the way you thought it was going to happen. And you kept saying, God, I thought you said this was the year of restoration. And he said, it is. But part of restoration is that I got to get rid of things that don't belong. Jimmy, clarify for me. When you restore a house, you begin, as you restore it, you begin to take off the sheetrock. And as you take off the sheetrock, the reason you're taking off the sheetrock is because you want to see what's behind the walls. Uh-oh. God is beginning to remove the sheetrock in your life. And it's getting a little uncomfortable. And you don't like the way that it feels. See, but God, for you to get, you asked for it. You asked for revival. You asked for restoration. You wanted it. And he said, baby, I'm here. But it's going to cost you something. Woo. God is in the process of removing walls. He's removing sheetrock. See, because the reason you got to remove sheetrock is you got to find out what's behind the walls. You got to find out if you got any infestations. Woo. You got to see if you got any rodent infestations. You got to find out if you got any termite infestations. You got to get down to the walls. You got to get down to see if you got any rotted wood. Lord, God is pulling the walls back. He is pulling the walls back because he's trying to get to your rotted wood so that he can replace, he can remove the rotted wood and he can place it with good wood. See, he's trying to get rid of the termite infestation that's in your house. He's trying to get rid of the rodent infestation that's in your house that you've allowed to be there. Notice what I said, that you've allowed to be there. You allowed those rodents to set up tent in your home. You've allowed those rodents to set up camp in your house behind your wall. Whatever that is for you. If it's pornography, God said it can't be there no more. If it's lust, God said it can't be there no more. If it's anger, God said it can't be there no more. If it's rejection, God said, baby, I didn't reject you. If it's unforgiveness, God is trying to deal with it. If it's jealousy, what are you jealous of? People ain't showing you their real selves anyway. Why are you jealous of what they're showing you? Everybody's got problems. Everybody's got issues. Everybody's got something going on in their life. Everybody's sick. That's why Jesus is here. That's why he's here. He is pulling back the walls and he is getting into your business and you don't like it. But at the end of the day, God is saying to you today, if in the event that I choose to shut up heaven and send no rain, will you still choose me? Will you still choose me? Ooh. Come on, 2022 is what? The year of what? Whether you like it or not, baby, God is in the restoration business. He is in the restoration business. And part of restoration is that he is getting rid of stuff that he gave you an opportunity to get rid of it and you chose not to. He gave you that point. But then we said, we did just like Solomon. We said, God, we want revival and we want restoration. He said, okay, I'm here. He said, I'm here now, baby. Now let me tell you what you're going to have to do to get it. You want it? The question is, how much are you willing to pay? How much are you willing to pay to see restoration come to pass? Verse 14. Woo! But then he said this. He said, if, Lord, if my people, woo! Who is there anybody in this place that are God's people? God said, if my people, in the event that my people choose, if my people, which are called by my name, the thing I love about the beginning of the scripture is that God is taking ownership of you and me. He said, you mine, baby. He said, I know you're messy. I know you got drama in your life. I know you got some ugly stuff in your life. I know when I pull back the walls, I'm going to find a rat infestation. I'm going to find a termite infestation. I know I'm going to find some rotten wood. He said, but you're my people. You're my people. And you are called by my name. He said, you're mine and I'm yours. Woo! If you don't get nothing else today, baby, get that. Leave with that. Leave with you are his and he is yours. Leave with that, baby. You can live on that. But then he said this. But God is also telling us, listen to me. If my people who are called by my name, guess what he's saying? See, because in this scripture, he's fixing to get to restoration. But what he's saying is, revival and restoration starts with his people. Listen to me. We are praying that God would send an awakening to the world. Lord, save everybody that's not saved. Wake everybody up. Revive everybody. He said, I can't do it yet because you're not revived. I can't revive anybody else if my own people aren't revived. I got to revive my people first. If my people who are called by my name, revival starts with you, baby. Revival starts with me. It starts with his people. It doesn't start outside of these four walls. It starts inside. Because guess who's going to be part of the revival to the county, to the city, to the state? Guess who's going to do that? You are. I am. It's got to start with us first. See, each one of you have a realm of influence in your life. How much are you willing to pay? I wonder if everybody around you knows. I wonder if everybody in your realm of influence knows that God is first in your life. I wonder if that's the fruits that you produce. I wonder if I asked your coworkers, man, did you know Bobby was saved? See, I wonder if they would tell me, yes, he is. Did you know Bobby was a minister? I wonder if they told me. I wonder if they tell me he was. Do you see revival and restoration? Do you see Bobby a different person? I hope they do. See, because the way this city and this county is going to be revived and restored is through you and me. That's why he told you it was going to be a sacrifice. You can't say what you want to say anymore. Me and my church administrator have that conversation 4 days a week. And that's my church administrator, and so I can use her as an example. No, ma'am, you can't say that. You can't say what you want to say anymore. Not if you want to see the glory. You can't do what you want to do anymore. Not if you want to see the glory. You can't go where you want to go anymore. Not if you want to see the glory. He said, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves. Lord, have mercy. Woo, that's the first thing we got to do. Lord, have mercy. When you look up that word humble in its Hebrew content, you know what it means? It means to bend the knee. I don't know about you, but I like movies from that realm that talk about bending the knee. Because see, what they're saying to an individual is, look, the king is going around and the king is saying, I am king. And I need for you to bend the knee to show support, meaning that I am your king and you're willing to listen and do what I ask you to do. Uh-oh. See, God is asking us to humble ourselves and to bend the knee. He's asking us to determine who our God is. He's asking you to determine. It's time for you and I to determine who our God is. See, is it God Almighty or is it you? Is it God Almighty or is it your career? Is it God Almighty or is it your finances? Is it God Almighty or is it your family? I'm not saying your family is a bad thing, but God's got to come first. God has to come first. You are no good to your family if you come first. If they come first, you are no good to them. But if God comes first, you are a benefit to them. You can bring revival and restoration in your family. Humble yourself. Bend the knee. Because the last time I checked, when I lived my life based upon what I wanted to do, and I was God, I messed it all up. I got consequences today that I'm paying for when I was God in my life. At some point, we got to bend the knee, baby. You got to make a determination. Who is going to be God in your life? That's the first step to restoration in your life and to revival in your life, is humbling yourself and determining who is God in your life. And I pray every day I do. You're going to dislike me because I'm praying every day that the Holy Ghost would go forth. And anytime you try to put yourself as God, that God would remind you that you are not God. That God would treat you just like he treated Job. And he asked Job, where were you when I was creating the heavens and the earth? Where were you at? Every time you try to put yourself as God, I pray that the Holy Ghost would sick you and that he would get to you and that he would remind you that it is God Almighty that has brought you to this place. But then it said, after humble yourselves, it says, humble yourselves and pray. Woo. Listen to me. Humble yourselves and pray. I need you to understand something about prayer. prayer is a beautiful thing. Some of you may look at it as an obligation. Some of you may look at it as something I have to do. Some of you may look at it, I could be doing something else besides praying. But I need you to understand what prayer is. Prayer gives you access to heaven. Prayer gives you access to heaven, and it unlocks. It unlocks heaven and allows heaven to come down and be here on earth. Prayer gives you access to heaven. See, that's why the Bible says that which is bound up in heaven is bound up on earth. That which is loosed in heaven is loosed on earth. Prayer allows you to experience heaven on earth. Prayer allows you to experience heaven on earth. But if you're not in fellowship with God, ain't no restoration coming. Because you're still doing what you want to do. You're still going where you want to go. You're still saying what you want to say. If you're not praying, see, because the more I pray, the more I become like Jesus. The less I pray, the more I become like me. So not only do you have to bend the knee, but you got to be in fellowship with God. But then it says this. He said, Lord, I keep losing my place. It said, and seek my face. Don't seek him when you need something. Don't seek him when you need to rub the genie. Seeking God's face is not simply an acknowledgement of who God is. It's seeking God in every aspect of your life. When a decision comes up, before you make it, spend time with God. I don't care how small you think it is, but that's seeking the face of God. It's not seeking his hand. It's not seeking what he can give you. It's seeking who he is and his nature and his character. It's seeking who he is in every aspect of your life. When you got to buy a house, guess what? You better be seeking God first. When you got to buy a car, you better be seeking God first. Don't you go and do that on your own. Let me tell you something. Pastor just had to buy, I had to buy a new car. What? I didn't want to. If anybody knows me, I'm cheap. I was put in a position where I had to. I had a vehicle and I took care of that thing like never before. I did everything I was supposed to. And the engine went out on it. Just a bad car, I guess. Because even when I took it to the dealership, they said, man, you taking care of this car. It's on record. You've done everything you're supposed to. Maintenance did, you did all that stuff. And the engine went out. It was only 75,000 miles on the car. Engine went out. And he said, it's going to be $10,000, because it was a hybrid. It's going to be $10,000 to replace the car, $9,500 to replace the engine. I said, sir, the car ain't even worth $9,500. The car's not even worth $9,500. Well, I'm paying $9,500 for an engine, and it's not even worth it. And so he said, you probably can get away with it for a few months, maybe even a year. And so I said, okay, well, I surely wasn't fit to make a decision at that point. And so I was praying and I was praying. Paula told me, you need to get a new car. I said, no, I don't. I need to do exactly what I'm doing right now. My daughter told me, I don't even want you picking me up at school in your car. She said, I don't even like the way it sounds. Why does it sound like that? I said, you better get in this car and come on here, girl. Shoot. Quit playing. My wife didn't even want to ride in the car with me. Y'all bougie than a mother. Shoot. Y'all better quit playing. See, I found out real quick, if we go broke, ain't nobody in my house gonna be happy. I can tell you right now. But I said, I did. And my wife said, you need to go get a new car. I said, no, I don't want to. I don't have that peace yet. I said, if I get a new car, it's going to have to be something that's an unbelievable price for me to have to go get that. And I said, no, I ain't going to go do it. She said, no, go look. I said, fine, I'll look. I said, Lord, again, if you do this, it's the only way I'm doing it is if you do it. And sure enough, the first car I looked at, it was a 2017 Cadillac that I have now. That car didn't have hardly any miles on it. It was $50,000 when they bought it originally. Man, I got that thing for like $17,000. I said, Jesus, that's the only way. That's the only way I'm buying this car. But it's because I didn't run out and just go do something on my own. I said, Jesus, you're going to have to give me direction on this because I don't really want to do it. I'm cheap. I'd rather just roll around with loud noises. And then finally, he said this in the scripture. He said, so if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways. Listen to me. Turn from the wicked ways. See, in other words, don't just tell God you're sorry. In other words, don't just tell God that you're sorry. Don't just give a verbal acknowledgement that you've done wrong. Don't just give a verbal acknowledgement that you have issues. Don't just give a verbal acknowledgement that you have mess in your life. He said, now that you know it, do something about it. Turn, repent, turn from your wicked ways. Don't do the same thing that you've been doing. You got to do something differently. You got to change your behaviors. You got to change your associations. Woo. You got to be willing to accept accountability. Woo, it's quiet now. How much are you willing to pay? Because then after that, God says this. He said, after all that happens, he says, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. He said, then, he said, once you humble yourself, once you pray, once you seek my face, once you turn from your wicked ways, he said, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive your sins. You will be cleansed and then I will heal your land. And that word heal, when you look it up, it means restore. And then when you look up that word land, it says the inhabitants of the land. Woo! So God is going to restore the inhabitants of the land. Who are the inhabitants of the land? You and I are the inhabitants of the land. And God is saying to you that if you will do these things, if you choose to do that, restoration will come to you and your household. It will come to you. God will do it. But the question is, how much are you willing to pay? Everybody bow your heads. Father, thank you so much for being real with us today. Thank you so much for your love. Thank you so much for your mercy. Thank you so much for your grace. Thank you for your word. Thank you for your anointing. Thank you for your power. Thank you for everything that's happening. And I trust you this day, God. Father, I thank you because we ask for revival, we ask for restoration, and you're saying I'm here, but it's going to cost you something. So, Lord, I pray that you bring this word back to our remembrance and ask us how much are you willing to pay so that we can see the glory revealed in our lives, Father. So I bless you this day in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, guys. At this time, we're going to do Holy Communion. We're going to do Holy Communion at this time. So if the ushers will take their places. Thank you, man. I know. Here, Mighty One Worship Center, the way that we do Holy Communion, we do it all together as a family. The ushers will begin to direct you to come forward to get your Holy Communion. You have the option of going back to your seats, or you can do it at the altar as well. Once you get in place, we will do Holy Communion together as a family, okay? So at this point in time, I will turn it over to the ushers, and they will lead you to get your Holy Communion. And then if you're in the balcony, they have it in the balcony for you as well. Is there anyone that has not received their Holy Communion at this point? If you have not, we'll get it to you. Just raise your hand if you haven't. Okay. So I grew up in a church that said, hey man, you better make sure you're right with God before you take